This is an amazing story of an IS-300 that evolved into the horsepower king of the 2000s, built to an amazing level, and then suddenly lost to time. We rescued it from a dusty grave in New York, loaded it in the back of a semi, and brought it back to Colorado. Can it be restored back to greatness? This is its resurrection. This is Back from the Dead. Last time, on Back from the Dead, we find the car in pretty rough shape. We load it up and send it on its way. The truck from New York would take at least 3 days, no matter how you cut it. Now, while we waited for transport, it was back to work at Figs. It was a pretty typical week, doing some custom fabrication, some custom machining, and assembling some of our standard products. Needless to say, there's not a dull moment around the shop. If you'd like to know more, you can follow this link. It was later in the week that we got the call. Bring a trailer. So it was time to load up the truck and get down to the pickup spot, which was about 26 miles away. Now, how long do you think it took us to get there, in contrast to New York? So, anytime you transport a vehicle, I think there's always a risk that something happens during transport. So, it was extremely important to see what actually looked like inside the trailer. The good news is, everything was in perfect shape. Our tie downs worked really well. Remember, we had to anchor those to the hardwood floor of the trailer, and couldn't have been happier with what we saw when we opened up those doors. Then it was just the task of getting it out of there. Now, we didn't have a loading ramp to get the car out of the trailer, but this really meant that we'd have to come up with an alternate solution. I leave it to Ilya to be the brains behind this portion because he'd done this before. We load up their normal car-carrying open trailer and use the ramps to get it out of the semi. From there, we would take it down to the last leg, which would be our trailer.
Yeah, I mean, it's spilling out of the exhaust.
So while we started going over the finer details of the undercarriage, there were a lot of things that were jumping out. There were good things, like the V160 transmission looked like it didn't have any leakage or oil coming out of it. But there were some other things that didn't look so good, like the blown couplers on the exhaust and some clear fluid that was on the tailpipe, possibly coming from the rear axle. So we would definitely need to go over this with a fine-tooth comb and really step carefully before we tried to start this thing. Now the last leg was to get it onto the car trailer. And this was a little bit more of a challenge than we expected. The offload ramps didn't quite put it at the right height, so we had to do a little bit of maneuvering to get everything lined up and save things like the front bumper, and also really just making sure that we were pacing ourselves and not doing it too quickly.
You can telescope, right?
Bring the trailer.
Bring it forward.
You'll make it higher. Just a little bit. But we
What you need to do, my friend, what you need to do right now is you need to card hard left. Hard left.
With a little bit of help from a floor jack and some wooden blocks, we just barely squeaked by, got the car on the trailer, had a little run-in with the winch when we rolled it back, but the results came out pretty good. With the car loaded on the trailer, it made its journey back to Figs, where the true transformation would really begin. I think at this point we should step back and answer a few questions. What made this car so great? And what was the chronology of how it was built? I made this quick timeline, rebuilding it from the data that I could extract from the old forum days. And you can pause the video right now and just take a look at how things were built. This was definitely an evolution. And I think the most important thing is that a lot of the development happened on the 2001 model. It wasn't until 2004 that basically a brand new car was transformed, given the information and the data from the previous build. With SRT, the original builder of the vehicle, closing its doors in 2017, I think that fed into the reasons of why to sell the vehicle. In short, if you look at the focus shift between the car to more important things in Charles's life, like his family and running his business, it's pretty simple to see. The car simply just didn't fit anymore. So let's take a moment to talk about the project process and how we go about determining our path. So if we look at any project, really anything that we have a goal to work towards, we define that as a linear path, right? We have a starting point, an ending point. We have a set of unknowns and we have a set of knowns that really come to us after we perform some type of action to get to them. And while we always visualize this as a linear path, in other words, an A to B path, I think everyone knows that the reality is we will not get there in a straight line. There will be tangents, there will be setbacks, there will be parts that we need to wait for, there will be people we need to hear back from. And so the actual path looks a little bit more like this. It's weaving, it's going backwards and forwards. And so in reality, especially with life factors like family or other expenses intruding on what we would like to do with our project, it can be a pretty daunting task to actually get to completion, especially when you're looking at something with a large scope. So for the first part of this project, we had to identify our first step, and that was really getting the windows up. And in order to get the windows up, we needed a new battery or a new power source. And this was going to expose a lot of information, really, that would lay a foundation for where we would move next. So unfortunately, the first night we did not have room in the shop to unload both all of the auxiliary items, namely the seats and wheels, as well as a place for the car. So I had to carry this to my house, where I would be trying to apply the power via a jump station. Now, we just so happen to have really good weather in Colorado. This is in, you know, the beginning of summer. So it wasn't a big deal to leave this car out. However, had to get these windows up just to seal up the car and make sure that we could really button it up for the evening. So this meant disconnecting the primary battery, because that would just drag the charge down, and using the jump station as a primary power source, just for the time being. Now, initially, I made the mistake of just hooking it up, and I'd forgotten that the car being in such deep, the battery being so dead, that actually it would turn on the alarm, so that's what happened here. So eventually I put the key in the ignition.
That's a good sign.
So I applied power.
Probably gonna start.
And this is how it went down. This damn trunk.
Okay, so now I got the key in the ignition, so hopefully we don't get a horn and wake my kids up. Oh, listen to that. Look at that, we have power. We have power. We can roll up windows. We can close sunroofs. Amazing. Oh my gosh. Look at the odometer. You see that? Crazy. So basically, guys, this is a brand new car. It's a 2004 with 5,900 original miles.
So the next day in the sunlight, you know, really even picking up the car, we were kind of in the dusk and we were rushed, so we didn't have time to appreciate some of the details. So here's a few I thought you might enjoy. Getting power applied to the car, this is what we learned. We learned that all the gauges work. We learned that the windows work. I could hear the fuel pump come on. So there were a lot of positives just from this simple act of replacing the power source. So the real reason to get the windows up, of course, was to give this thing a bath. It was filthy, covered in dust from sitting in that garage for 9 years. So without further ado, this is how it went. Actually pretty amazed at how well the wax was still beading. All that dust came off super easy, and for the most part, this car was looking pretty good after the car wash. I spent the next few days with the car on the trailer because we still had a VIN inspection, part of the out-of-state vehicle inspection process to get it titled. And there was also the possibility that we would need to fill it with fresh gas once we evaluated that. really, I just didn't have a spot for it in the shop. I guess I could say that. Things were a little bit packed, hadn't cleared out a spot for the shop, so it was gonna play piggyback on the Tundra while I drove it around and did our normal errands. So that's it for episode 2. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Stay tuned for the next episode where we do a baseline engine mechanical. We will do a leak down, do an oil inspection, and we'll also give this thing a start and see what it sounds like after 9 years. Like and subscribe. I hope you enjoyed this video. And again, if you have any questions about FIGS Engineering, the products that we make, or the services that we offer, please visit www.shopfigs.com, visit our blog, go to Facebook, like our page, stay tuned for more updates. Thanks again for watching.
This is one reason why this car cover was never used. It doesn't fit.